कैमरा इज उल्टा। Very good morning, viewers. Welcome you all. So sorry for the delay. We had a bit of a glitch with the network. So welcome you all again. As promised, we are here, and today we bring to you a topic which I think all of us, think about a lot, on relationships and strengthening relationships. So here, over to Dr. Ali on this discussion. Please feel free to write your questions to Dr. Ali.
Very good morning. Sorry, we have to, I think, build better relationships with technology before we build better relationship with ourselves. Extremely sorry for the delay. Relationships, close relationships, they affect us much more than any other single aspect in life. I may have financial problems, I may have health problems, I may have any other issues and problems. It doesn't affect me as much as if I have relationship problems. And relationships with whom? With our closest, most important, near and dear, etc. If I have good relationships with my nearest and closest people, I can handle anything. It is said that home, a family, is defined as the place where you go out and do whatever you want, and when you come back and knock on the door, they have to open the door and let you in. That is the beauty of close relationships, family, whatever you want to call it. Where and how does this start? Somebody very cutely said, when a small child, a baby, starts growing up, he or she goes through three stages. The first one is, hold me tight. When mummy lets go of the baby starts bawling. The moment mummy lifts her up and holds him tight, he is very happy. So the first phase is, hold me tight. The second phase is, put me down. Now I want to go and explore the world, so you put me down, I'll start crawling, I'll start walking, I'll go, whatever has to be done, I will do. The third stage is, leave me alone. I've had enough of you guys, okay, thank you very much. Keep cooking and feeding me, give me my pocket money, but otherwise, please leave me alone. That's in a lighter vein, of course. But why I brought this up is that relationships start at a very early age. Relationships start at a very early age, and the way the relationships are, put it on, light on, light on please, thank you. Relationships start at a very early age. Everything depends on relationships. A child who does not get proper relationships, does not get, you know, love and care and cuddling and talking, child may have everything else, physical security, economic security, all these things, but still a child does not grow up with the same type of, the holistic development that the child needs. And then we enter into the adult world. What happens here? Ask yourself this. That everything revolves around your close relationship. In fact, when people ask me the concept of, let's say, mental health, today we are talking so much about well-being, mental health and all these things, particularly after that very tragic suicide that took place in the Bollywood. When people ask me, how do you define good mental health? I always tell them in very simple Rancho terms, peace within yourself and harmony with your significant people around you. Peace within yourself is entirely your call. You have to maintain certain skills, you have to develop certain, you know, self-awareness, management of your emotions, setting your motivation. All these things lead to peace within yourself. That's in your control. But the more tricky part of the thing is the harmony with others. And when I say others, I am talking about your significant others. You can have very good relationship in your entire locality, in your office, in your club, and wherever, and of course on social media. But how is your relationship with your nearest and dearest? That is what determines how happy, how fulfilled, how contented you are. That is what determines what sort of steps you will take, what sort of actions you will take, how you will, you know, feel motivated, how you will balance your life, how you will, you know, face challenges and all these type of things. So let's start with some very quick and basic things about relationship. Then we'll move on. As I said, we'll have a lot of questions and doubts and comments and all that. Let's make it interactive in the second half particularly. So let me start off with first thing, telling you that, you know, all relationships are dynamic. They keep changing. So this thing of, you know, A and B married and lived happily ever after, I think is a big misnomer, which is causing a lot of misconceptions and making people feel very contented with themselves, because you think that once you've found the ideal relationship, then everything goes fine. No. Relationships are all dynamic. Relationships keep changing from time to time. I remember this wonderful old lady who was maybe at that time around 85 or so, and she had her husband more or less of the same age. And, you know, she used to very happily tell her husband that, you know, I love you today. Tomorrow I don't know. Next month I don't know. Next year I don't know. But I want to express to you that I love you today. It was such a beautiful thought by a person who had been married for 60 years to the same man and who had continued living with him for 60 years and loving him. But she was realistic enough to say that I love you today. How many of us have got that ability to say it? And how many of us on the receiving end will be happy to get, you know, a truthful message like that? But that is a fact. So be prepared that all relationships are changing. They are dynamic. They are not static. The second thing equally important is that relationships need to be nurtured. The closer the relationship, the greater the nurturing has to take place. You cannot take relationships for granted. Most of the close relationships that have deteriorated or even have fizzled off completely, my experience has been that it did not happen overnight. People think that way. Oh, we were having such a good relationship, we were such good friends, or between husband and wife we were so happy, or my relationship with my child was fantastic. Then one fine day something happened and they say everything has gone for a toss. It doesn't happen that way. It is like a big tree which has come up, and you look at that huge tree and you say, great, fantastic. See how strong it is. Nobody, nothing can shake this tree. But somewhere if you look deep down into the roots, you will realize that the roots are not getting the type of nutrition. And therefore the tree is becoming weaker. Or you may have white ants, you know, deep inside the tree trunk, which are eating up the trunk and making it hollow, and you won't even realize till one fine day the whole thing just topples over. So the same way, relationships have to be nurtured at all times. Please never ever take any relationship for granted, however close it is. Sorry to say something very controversial, which many of you may not like and may even get angry with me for saying it. There is no such thing as unconditional love. If that was the case, then, you know, nobody would put any conditions on their love. So once a man and woman say that, you know, we live happily ever after, they would say, go enjoy yourself, have as many boyfriends and girlfriends, spend off all your money, do whatever you want, and I'll give you unconditional love. Let's be pragmatic, no? It doesn't happen that way. And why it doesn't happen that way is the third aspect of relationships I wanted to tell you, that all relationships are built on expectations. If you have outside your house on your way to work, maybe a beggar, a person who is physically challenged, who cannot earn for himself, so he is there, poor man, and he is asking for charity. And you give it to him. You give him money or you give him food or whatever it is, you know, you take care of a lot of his needs every now and then. And you even say hi to him and he pays his respects to you, whatever happens. But would you say you have a relationship with him? Would you like to invite him to your house on your birthday and say, come and join us for our birthday party? No. At the most, you will make some goodies and sweets and tell somebody, go and give it to that poor beggar who's sitting outside on the road. So the point is that we do not have a relationship and therefore there are no expectations. But if you have, let's say, a neighbor to whom you have been doing some good deeds, you've been helping her out, you've been sharing food whenever, you know, there is a need there or something. If you really want that to evolve into a friendship, you start having expectations. One fine day you get up and say, every time I'm doing so much for her and she's not doing anything for me, I think I'd like to cool off. That is only a relationship like a neighbor or a friend or whatever it is. Now, I am talking about very close relationships, your own family people, maybe your parents, siblings, spouse, child, anybody who you consider your best friend and that sort of thing. It does not exist without expectations. The only issue is, are the expectations reasonable according to the other person? If they are not, if the other person feels tense, constrained, pulled, if the other person feels that no, this expectation from the other person is too much for me, I can't come up to that expectations, that is when the relationship starts deteriorating. That brings me to another very important issue. When I mention close relationships, they should not be too close. Anyway, this corona has taught us that, you know, you maintain social distancing from each other. I am also talking about emotional distancing every now and then. Do you cling on to each other? Do you want everything to be done together? Do you want to be physically together 24/7? Do you want all activities to be done only together? Take an example. Supposing your friend comes and says, oh, we've been locked up for so many days. Now, when once everything is through, we have decided that we'll go and have a nice vacation. And we will unwind and we will have, you know, joys of being away from home and all those type of things. We'll do that and we'll come back. Both my husband and wife have decided that. So, you ask, where are you going? And she says, my husband loves beaches, so he's going to Goa. I love the hills, so I am going to Ooty. How does it sound? The other person who's listening will probably say that's the end of the marriage. If they can't even take a vacation together, how long is this marriage going to last out? I'll tell you how long. It will last out much longer and in a much better quality of relationship than most of the people who force each other and go for vacations together or something of that sort. Yes, Shika, thanks that you agree that there's no unconditional love. Please think over, those of you who disagree with me, do give it a thought. So I come back to the point that you need to give space to each other. You need to understand each other's needs and say that, okay. And we need to give the other person what the other person wants, not thrust something down their throat. Just to give a simple example, in this last 2-3 months, I have had so many people who have decided to lock up their parents. The government locked them up, fine. The government has unlocked them, but the children don't want to unlock them. They don't want them to step out of the house. They don't want them to meet anybody. They don't want them to do anything just because they are senior citizens. Now, if you allow me to be a little impertinent, I think all the people who are ruling our country are senior citizens. I think we should first lock them up, isn't it? No, we can't do that. Yes, you have to take precautions, but you can't label them. The same thing is happening with children. You can't permanently lock up people. So you have to give space, you have to understand what their needs are, that's how you need to move on. Now if you are under pressure, if you have a close relationship and that person is becoming a little, what do you say, dominating, and the person is not allowing you to do what you want, how do you deal with it? Dealing with it, you need to learn a very basic human skill. It's not very difficult, but it takes a lot of practice to actually, you know, master it after you've understood the nuances. That is a skill called assertiveness. Can you be assertive with the other person? Most of the time, we are either dominating or we are submissive. Alice has said just now very nicely that I find a middle way, negotiate with close relationships. Yes, how do you negotiate this? You have to be assertive. You don't argue, you don't fight, and you don't give in. There's a middle path which is always available to you. So when you look at this middle path and how to go about the thing, let me first show you what is not assertiveness, and then we'll see what is assertiveness. So here is a parent and child who are having differences on certain things. When they are not assertive, just see how they deal with it.
Meera, what is this? Your room is again so messy. You're so shabby. Why don't you clean your room?
Yeah, so what? It's my room. But I'll do whatever I want.
I mean, you're always like that. I have told you every time and you don't listen to me. Everybody says this about you.
Let them say. I don't care.
You have to clean this. I don't know how you're going to do that.
I like living like this. Please don't interfere.
I don't know what I can do with this girl.
This is what happens. This is what happens. The mother has become helpless, saying, I don't know what to do with this girl. But if the same mother was assertive instead of starting off shouting at her daughter, how would she deal with it?
Hey, Meera, I know you've been busy with your exams and you've not found the time to clean your room. But you know what? I'd like you to clean your room.
Whatever. I don't feel like.
You know what, Meera? Your grandmom's coming this Sunday and she'll feel very welcomed, right? If you clean your room and keep it ready.
Okay, whatever.
Yeah, so you know what you do? By Saturday, you clean the room. And if you think you need any help, let me know. But let me know a little bit in advance so that I can just wrap up other things and come and help you out. Alright?
Okay, will you help me?
I'll do that. Let me know.
But. Okay, but just this one time. Okay?
Sure enough.
Okay.
Nice, good.
Now, don't expect miracles. Don't expect that you are assertive and suddenly your rebellious teenager becomes very, very obedient and very, very loving. It doesn't happen. But nothing happens overnight. You have to work towards it. This was just a quick demo to help you to understand that you have to make that beginning. You have to start moving in that particular direction. As long as you are doing that, it takes time, it takes effort. There will be ups and downs, but eventually you will succeed. This applies for any type of thing. For example, let's take, in any close relationship, inevitably, you can't always be nice to the person. You can't always be smiling and say, okay, do what you want and I'm happy whichever way and things like that. No, it doesn't work that way. There are times when you have to discipline somebody. There are times when you have to criticize somebody. There are times when you have to stop somebody from. And I'm not even talking about parenting and children. It could be, as I mentioned, it could be your elder parent, you know, who is saying something which you don't like and you want to bring about a change. It could be just about anybody as long as it's a close relationship. So what do? We tend to criticize the person. We tend to put the person down by saying, you are good for nothing, you are doing this wrong, you are doing that, all those type of things, isn't it? And this continuously has a sort of negative effect. We don't even realize how much the relationship is getting damaged, how much strain is building up between the two people. Just because we are part of family or we are closely connected or something of that sort, it just goes on like that. But we have to take it clear. I'm not saying you should stop criticizing people. You should, if it's a person close to you, and if you feel that constructive criticism and suggestions will help, it will bring about the change. So you have to criticize. But don't do it in a way that it makes matters worse. Instead of motivating the person to change, it actually makes the person adamant. That's what happens sometimes. How? Let us see.
You're still not ready, Sunita.
Arre, just give me a few minutes, yaar.
Arre, we are going, we are getting late. Everybody's waiting for you. You're always getting us late.
I'm not always late.
Last time also we missed the movie because of you. This is not done at all. I don't like this about you at all.
If the movie is so important, nah, you guys carry on. I'll get an auto or something.
Done. Go.
See what happened? It started with good intention, but it has ended up in a very, very wrong note. Now, can the same person say, I want to be critical, I want to help her to change her habit, but I'll do it in a more constructive or a more positive manner? How?
Sunita, ready?
Yeah, just 2 minutes. You know what, why don't you guys carry on? I'll get an auto, yeah?
Hey, no, you'll all get messed up in an auto. And you know what, we wanted to go together, right? So, let's do that. And moreover, look, you're looking so pretty, you're looking so good, and we decided to go together. It's always fun to have you around. No, we have to go together, right? But you know what, you have to be a little more punctual, so take care of the time the next time.
Yeah, I know. Next time I'll ensure that, all right? So this time, just give me 2 minutes.
1 minute?
Okay, right, I'll be ready.
Right, catch you.
You may be thinking, does it work? You may immediately be thinking of somebody in your family or somebody close to you and say, hey, I've tried all these things, yeah, it doesn't work. You know why? Because you tried it once, twice, got frustrated, criticized the person even more. See, I was so nice to you, I allowed you this and I did that and still nothing happened. Now, habits take a long time to build. We have to work on that. Let me wind up the first part, half of this session, by giving you just a few very important and very quick tips. Then we will have an open house. Please feel free to start typing in your doubts, questions and comments and things like that. But before that, as I told you, one is that society and families and all that are moving more and more into what we are defining, what we are referring to as undefined relationships. Earlier, we were bound to our own family, our joint family, our extended family, our community members and all that. Now that is no longer true, right? So every time that you are building a relationship with new people, please be aware that it's very easy to have a quick thing, good initial, opinions or people just being, putting on a good impression and the thing starting off well. But many a time it does not last. So I have a request to you. If you feel the need to build up more and more relationships, friends and this and that, please first work on your existing relationships. If there is something wrong and if you are criticizing all the time and saying these relationship is not working out well, that's why I'm trying out new ones, it doesn't help. Lot of people make that mistake. It doesn't work that way. Please keep working on your close relationship. How much do you express your love and affection? I always bring this up in a lighter way. That in English, it's such a common thing to tell somebody, I love you. But ask yourself, are you equally comfortable saying just this simple message of I love you in your mother tongue? People falter. People don't know what to say. And when I ask them, when did you last say this to somebody with whom you have a long-term close relationship? Many people have not done it. If you're doing it, I'm extremely happy. Some people even go to the extent of saying, my wife knows that I love her. Why do I have to keep repeating all the time? Doesn't it sound silly? No, it doesn't sound silly. It's very reinforcing. It strengthens the relationship. Just to get to know verbally. and back it up with non-verbal things. At least with your near and dear, I'm sure that nobody will mind if you don't maintain social distancing. Touch, for example, plays such an important role in life. And now that you are abstaining from touch from others because of this lockdown and restrictions and all that, at least with your immediate near ones, use as much touch as possible. It really reinforces the relationship, and it really makes the thing go into a very, very positive demeanor. The last point. Never be an emotional beggar. Do not beg for love. You don't get it. I come back to the example that I gave you about the roadside beggar to whom you give food. You don't build a relationship with him. You don't invite him home. You don't make him part of your celebrations or anything of that sort. So the same thing happens with somebody who is an emotional beggar. If I go on begging, whoever it may be, my parent, my sibling, my spouse, my child, whoever it is, if I keep begging for, love, I only get charity. I don't get a chance to convert that love into a two-way relationship, which is what our intention should be. So please keep working on that. Just a few very important and simple points. I'd like, Purnima, to just give you a quick update on what we do in terms of, building stronger relationships and things of that sort. And then let's have an open house.
Good morning, viewers. Taking you through, what I thought is I'll show you a little different dimension of how you can build your relationships, and that is going to be with through the help of books. We have put up a big banner over here, which is all about the books written by Dr. Ali Khwaja. He is the author of around 30 odd books and around 80 plus booklets. These booklets are just very quick to read, 15-16 pages, and the books which are over here are all about, everything relating to different ages. For example, there is one which says Understanding Today's Child. And then there is 30 Days to a Better Life. How you can do some simple small things and add quality to your own life. And of course, the most favorite topic, one of the most favorite topic, which is called Life Skills. Am I intelligent enough? Yes, I get 90 plus and I'm really, every time I'm a topper. How is my critical thinking, my creative thinking, my interpersonal relationship, my management of emotion, all comes through this simple, very practical book on life skills. Moving on, we have this book, which is Life Begins at 60. Quite often than not, we always end up feeling that abhi to retire ho gaye, abhi to kuch nahin. No, life begins at 60. And of course, we have Understanding Teenagers, right? And Mental Health. So you have so many books like this, and they are all on relationships. Moving on, and with your questions and clarifications, comes to you Dr. Ali again.
Yes. Can we buy this online? Mohin is asking. Yes, you can. Definitely, you can just contact through our website, any of these books you want. No, they are not available on Amazon or Flipkart because we've kept the prices so low that it's not practical for the distributors. They don't get sufficient commission out of the thing. We want to pass the benefit to the direct reader. How can someone overcome infidelity in a relationship when the couple wants to get back together and strengthen their relationship? Firstly, congratulations to a person who understands that a relationship is very holistic. And some form of infidelity, some mistake that one partner has made is not the end of the world. And, we don't go by ego and we don't just snap off. I think that's a very positive attitude to take. How to go about it is a very personal thing depending on what has happened. I think the first thing to do is that the person who has suffered because of the infidelity should work upon himself or herself stabilize emotions, understand where I am coming from, what my needs are, and then put it up to the partner and start working on it. Be ready that there will be a permanent crack in the relationship because of what has happened. Trust levels may be low, there may be irritability, but if you are willing to work it out when you have what we are defining as a life partner, life is very long, life expectancy is constantly increasing. So you imagine, you know, when you are 100 and your husband is 105 or something of that sort, even you may be shouting at your spouse, and your spouse after half an hour will say, okay, now I'll go and get my hearing aid, something of that sort. But do work on that. Elders in the family sometimes don't listen and force youngsters to keep quiet and listen to their elders. How to build a happy relationship with them? I'm sure there are many, many, many elders who are watching this program, and they say, youngsters in the family force us to keep quiet and they don't listen to us, etc., etc. It is a two-way thing. It is not, please don't label elders are like this, youngsters are like that. That is what we emphasize upon all the time, particularly in our counseling courses and all these things, that do not put labels on the people. For example, I know of people who have got two parents, a father and a mother, and they have this tendency of saying, my parents are like that, my parents behave that way. Your parents may be married to each other, but they are two individual human beings with their own brains and their own attitudes and their own thinking. So never club the people together. The same way sometimes parents do, my children don't listen to me. My children are like that. So if you have more than one child, please treat these people independently. Now the question, to answer the question, why should the elders listen to you? Have you set an example by listening to them? Start off by making them talk about it. Whatever has happened, what they have missed out in life, why they feel that things have changed for the worse or anything of that sort. Give them enough time to talk about it. And then ask them exactly what is it that you want. Set aside some time for you to listen. Say, Daddy, Mummy, I'm not going to talk for the next half an hour, but I really want to listen to you and understand what is going on in your mind. Then you come out with some issues and people will, you know. How do one who is always happy and celebrative, that sometimes won't realize that they too, as sometimes their own happiness becomes a mask to hide their, you know, stress. So how does one go about it? These are very individualized situations, Mohini. I don't know what is going on in the mind of that person. We need to explore a little bit. Why is that person putting on a mask and not, you know, showing what the person really means? We have to go deeper and see, this is all that relationships are all about, which I keep emphasizing. Don't look at one aspect that this person doesn't listen to me, or this person puts on a mask, or that person does that. Look at your relationship holistically. Take all the things into account. Then the issues that you have with this one person, bifurcate them into those which can be changed or resolved and those which cannot be. If probably I have an 80-year-old father who has certain idiosyncrasies and he says things which, you know, just don't suit me, can I accept the fact that he is not going to change now? He's spent 80 years of his life and people have obviously told him a number of times what to do. He did not listen. Now it's too late in the sunset years of his life to try to bring about a change. Here comes a very important thing. When you are talking about close relationships, please understand the difference between tolerating and accepting. As long as you keep tolerating, you are irritated. My mother behaves like this, my mother-in-law does this, or my son does this, or whatever it is. And you keep getting irritated, but you tell yourself, I'm tolerating. I will not fight, I will keep quiet. You are leading to worse situation in the relationship. That's why I said bifurcate. Those which you feel that it is futile to try to bring about a change. And somehow, whatever it is, I can live with it. It's not that I'm going to be crushed completely or I'm going to die because of this. Once you understand that, then you bring yourself to acceptance, not tolerating. Even though I don't like it, I agree to disagree. I allow that person to be whatever that person is. Then take up a few of those which you are very, very convinced that I cannot accept. I am only tolerating and things are becoming worse. Focus on those 1, 2, 3 issues rather than focusing on 10 differences that you have with that person. So when you tell that person that on issues 1, 2, 3, 4, I am accepting you, even though I don't agree with your approach, I respect that that's your way and I will not try to change you and I will accept you as is where is. So, can you please oblige me on issue number 5, 6 and 7 that we are facing with each other? The other person's, you know, willingness, the other person's attitude will definitely be a little softer to start with. And then keep building on those things.
Ali, there's a question that should I be the only one to compromise? I try really hard, but I think this person is so egoist and angry and rude all the time. So why should I, will my assertiveness be misunderstood?
Yes, your assertiveness will be misunderstood, particularly if you have been submissive for a very, very long time. The other person has taken it for granted that you will behave in a submissive and a passive manner. Now that you are trying to be assertive, the other person is not going to like it. The other person will get angry. The other person will attribute, you know, problems and intentions and things of that sort. The other person will try to put you down by saying things like, yeah, I know you went to your mother. No, your mother must have taught you all this. That's why you are behaving like this. Your mother is a horrible woman. Now you get even more worked up. Why is this person talking so badly about my mother or somebody like that? All this will have to be gone through if you are being assertive. One of the most important aspects of assertiveness is, those of you who are old enough to remember, once upon a time we used to have what are called as gramophone records. So you had a record player and we used to put that needle on it and the record player used to go round and round, round and round, and the song or whatever it is used to play. Now those round notches which were there, somewhere there would be a scratch. So when that record goes round, the needle jumps and goes back to the previous line. So every time that line is being sung, it goes back again to that line. So that is the technique that we use in assertiveness. Broken record technique, we call it. Be assertive to say, this is what I want. For example, I gave you this thing that, you know, the person starts blaming your mother and you're very clear that your mother has no role to play in it and you're getting very upset about it also. But can you look the person in the eye and say, I know you're angry. I know you don't like my behavior. I know you want me to change. But before we even start this process, can I make one thing clear to you? My mother has no role to play. It is not my mother who has told me this. The other person won't back off. As you said, if he is or she is an egoistic person, no, no, I know your mother very well. I know this is what happens every time that you go to your mother. Broken record. No, this is nothing to do with my mother. Yes, I visit my mother very regularly. We talk about a lot of things, but my mother doesn't influence my attitude or my decisions. Again, continue with the discussion third time, fourth time, fifth time. Slowly the person realizes that there is no point in making these type of allegations. And the person comes back to the issue. Argue on the issue, not on people. That is one fundamental mistake that we make. In close relationships, if I were to tell somebody, you are lazy, you are good for nothing, you don't love me, how can the other person, you know, prove these things to you? And what is the motivation for that person even to know? So as an assertive person, if you can tell that person, I'll be so happy if you could do this, this, this. I get very upset when I see that you have not cleaned your room or you have not done this, or when you are talking to somebody or whatever it is. I feel very upset when this happens. I would be extremely happy if you could express your love in different ways to reassure me that yes, we are having a very loving and caring relationship. That's how it goes.
Yeah. Sandhya is asking Ali, if one of the family members constantly find faults and criticizes you and has negative thought about me, how to build a good relationship with them, as I don't want to lose any one of them in my lifetime because of the emotional issues. Many times compromise many things, but which will be temporary and again it repeats.
Very true. That's why I said take up one issue at a time. Start off with agreeing on the issues where you have agreed to change. Where you feel that, okay, I don't think I can change this person because this person has certain ego, certain issues, certain indoctrination. So why waste time in arguing over it when I know I will not win this argument? So you bring it to the person and say, what I told you a few minutes back, I agree with you on this 1, 2, 3 issues. But in the same negotiating table, can you please help me? Can you please help me? Because issue number 4 and 5 hurt me and disturb me very badly. Sometimes with a person who is very emotional and very impulsive and, you know, tends to lose temper or something, you can even tell the person, please don't reply now. I just wanted to bring this to your attention in case you're not aware that this is what I'm feeling about it. I just wanted to clarify this. Take your time and respond to me. Please sleep over it. Tomorrow we'll discuss whatever has to be done.
Yali, so how does one deal with a relationship where the other person or spouse doesn't want to get into any discussion or conversation?
Yes. Communication, according to me, is the first pillar of any close relationship and more so about marriage. If you do not have communication at all, it is extremely difficult. One is that you tell the other person, have at least a one-sided communication going. If it is possible, keep making short 1 or 2 statements before the person, you know, gets upset and walks off or something like that. Just crisp statements. I want this to be done. I am happy about this. I am unhappy about this. I feel very low when this sort of situation happens. More than that, today we have innumerable means of getting a message across. You can send a message, you can WhatsApp the person, you can write an email, you can do so many different ways of doing it. If you still want to try out some very effective old formula, there were these, I don't know if they still exist, there were a lot of these housewives who used to write a handwritten note to their husband and quietly put it in their tiffin box and send it off. So when halfway through his working day, when he opens the tiffin box to have his food and that comes, he is comparatively in a much more calmer and situation where the person is willing to at least give a thought to it. So these are the type of things. None of them will get you overnight results, but you have to keep trying them out by trial and error. Some will work, some will not work. Some will work to a limited extent. But I assure you, when it comes to close relationships, if you have really suffered, like what you said just now, if it has been a one-sided relationship, you know something, that even if you get 10, 20, 30% change from the opposite person or some reciprocation, life looks to be beautiful.
Ali, this person asked that how do I communicate to my spouse when I am myself hurt and I am also healing? So how do we save that relationship?
Yes. If you are hurt and if you are still in the process of trying to heal yourself, please do not put that burden on your nearest and dearest. Let's say a divorce takes place and the mother perpetually keeps talking about her ex-husband to her child. That's not the right way of doing it. If I feel that I have been cheated of something and somebody has let me down and all that, and I keep telling this to my spouse every day, I am spoiling my relationship with my spouse because of some third person who has cheated me. So I can't, when it comes to these close relationships, you can't use them as emotional garbage bins. You have to get out your emotions. You are hurting. You need healing. Do it with somebody who is neutral. That's where the role of counselors comes in, and I'm not even talking about, you know, professional counselors or qualified counselors and all that. You may have one friend you know, who lives miles away from you and whom you hardly meet friend to friend, but whenever you have a chat, you feel so comfortable with each other, you connect to each other well, and that friend always gives you that emotional support. Use that friend for your emotional healing. If you want further, as I told you, go to a counselor. There are very good counselors available who will be able to help you in whatever way. You want to take one more step further, I always tell people that if you really feel that you want to improve in a holistic manner and improve all your relationships and to understand how to reach out and how to protect yourself from wrong relationships, become a counselor yourself. You don't need any theory or psychology background or anything of that sort. Every year we train 150 counselors, and one of the things that they say always is, I don't know how many people I have been able to help as a counselor, but one thing I know is my quality of life has improved. My relationships with my near and dear have improved. So there are so many ways of doing it. This is not the only one. Keep exploring relationships. I repeat what I told you in the beginning, are the most important aspect. Nothing can make you as happy or as sad as close relationships. So never let go. Keep nurturing those relationships. As I said, you know, if you find white ants in the tree, what will you do? You will cut it open, you will get some medicine, you will inject it, you will monitor it, and then only you will sit happily saying that I have done it. You have to continue this process.
Yeah, Ali, how do I enhance my relationship with my child in his pre-teen years?
Too general a question, no? We would all like to do it, and why only pre-teen, why not post-teen, and why not post-20, and why not post-80? The basic things remain the same. I told you, accept your child, your spouse, as is, where is, first, to start with. Secondly, listen. Listen more than you talk. All close relationships, everybody wants to talk. Nobody wants to, you know, listen. You take that step. Just allow that preteen to talk anything and everything under the sun. Do not stop, do not criticize, do not comment, do not question. Once you find that is happening, encourage that child to learn emotions. When the child comes and says, I was not selected for the cricket team, don't go into this thing, no, there is politics, it is okay, it doesn't matter, I'll put you in some other club. No. Start off by asking that child, how did you feel when you thought that you deserve to be in the team but you were not selected? That is what we talk about, emotional intelligence. Every human being needs to build up. Today, behavioral scientists tell us 80% of our success, fulfillment, happiness will depend on how good is our emotional intelligence. And emotional intelligence, as most of you may know, starts with self-awareness, moves on to management of emotions, moves on to motivation, which is really lacking in many children, moves on to empathy, putting yourself in the other person's shoes, and the culmination of that is the fifth and final pillar of emotional intelligence, that is social skills. How to deal with different types of people, happy situations, sad situations, and things of that sort. Anjali, thank you for saying that Banjara has helped you. We really feel very warm and nice. And Irshad even says, Banjara changes everyone's life to be happy. That's a little exaggeration, Irshad, but anyway, thank you so much for making that comment.
Yeah, Paruma is saying that the word counselor has become something that turns people quiet.
Very true, very true. We have to break that, no? We have to break that thing. One of my students was appointed a counselor in an engineering college. She was allotted a room, and outside she did not put up a board called counselor. She put a big emoticon and she wrote smiley. And when she goes into the classes to tell people that, you know, there are times when you feel a little upset, there are times when you're confused, there are times when your motivation goes down, what do you need to do? She says, come to me, I'll put a smile on your face. Now, she is known as Smiley Madam. She is not known as a counselor in her college. This is how innovative things can be done if you want.
Anupama says, also if a spouse is not expressive, Do we have to tune to them or make them more expressive to nurture one's relationship?
When you say not expressive, no, please understand that these are people who have not been taught how to express emotions. You take that same person, if he has to give a presentation on his domain specialization for a very important contract, he can talk 2 hours non-stop. He can describe to the minutest of detail what his organization can offer. So it does not mean that the person is not expressive. What the person has not been taught is to express emotions. That's what comes through in close relationships. So tease that person. That's what I meant by emotional intelligence. Self-awareness. Is that person aware of what he is going through? Whether he's sad, angry, jealous, happy? Can he do that? Then has he learned how to manage his emotions? Take that person through that little process. Initially, let it even be one-sided. It doesn't matter for some time. But eventually, the person will turn around.
I know sisters who love each other, but sometimes there is too much love that can also cause a fight. How can I help them?
First thing is to tell them to give space. They may be sisters, they may be living under the same roof, whatever it is. But tell them that the more you love each other, the more there is a need for space. So if every time they go out for a movie together, or every time they do their shopping together, or every time they have their meal together, tell them once in a while, don't do that. Give space to each other. Then teach them that when you love somebody and you want that love to reach the other person, don't express the love the way you want. Express the love in a way that she wants to receive. And if you are a keen observer, if you even ask frankly, the other sister will tell you what she wants, what makes her happy. Once you know that, start practicing giving it to her. Thank you, Mai. You said Banjara is changing your life too. Still, it is progressing. It's continuous work in progress. Till our last day of life, we are work in progress. That's how it goes. And more so with relationships, it goes on. Parama is asking, please elaborate on space. You should have physical space and emotional space. Physical space, as I told you, is where you say that, okay, you go for the movie with your friends, I will go shopping somewhere else. It's not necessary that both of us have to go to the movie or whatever it is together. You can go and spend this weekend in your parents' house. I'll take care of my needs and I'll do whatever I want, that sort of thing. Emotional space is where I told you, no, you don't burden your near and dear with everything. You don't come back home and start reeling out all the things that happened the day. You can talk about that to a neutral person, a counselor or somebody. And with this person, you do more of listening. That is the type of thing. More and more questions are still coming out. And any further book or talk available on this? Just now, that's what Purnima showed you. I have a good handbook on which is called All About Relationships, in which I've dealt with all relationships, more so the close ones. So you can pick up that book. We have small booklet. Those of you who say that I don't even want to read a 100-page book, please get into the habit of reading 16 pages. Very practical tapes, exercises and stuff like that. You have one I can show you. No, relationships. For example, just have a look at this. Important and close relationships. 20 pages of small size. I'm sure that over a period of time you can read these sort of things. So go ahead. It's a wonderful exercise. Like Navina says, counseling, learning is a beautiful journey. Yes, life itself can be made into a beautiful journey if we work towards it. Despite glitches, despite the fact that I think today it took us about 7 or 8 minutes to build a relationship with technology and the internet to be able to reach out to you people. But we don't give up, no. We keep making those efforts. We know that certain glitches will come in. The same way glitches will come in relationships. Accept them, move on, keep on a positive attitude. And wherever and whenever necessary, share with others and share others' issues. If we do that, life is going to be wonderful. The world is going to be a wonderful place. Enjoy yourself. Have a very, very nice weekend. And see you next Saturday, 11 o'clock. Bye-bye.
Thank you all so much for joining us. Thank you, Dr. Ali. Those were really good tips. In fact, you can come down here to our center and discuss if you are, going through any sort of an emotional, problem or you're feeling low. You are most welcome here. We have a group of dedicated trained counselors, will talk to you. And if you think you are that kind of a person who can reach out to others, you know, there are times when many people come to you for advice and when they are feeling emotionally low, you can actually learn to be a trained counselor yourself in a more systematic, scientific way. And we are, going to start our Diploma in Counseling Skill, a one-year part-time program shortly in the month of July end. So you can come and, enroll yourself for that as well. If you want more information, please call our office numbers. We'll be glad to help you. You can come and pick up any of the booklets that, Dr. Ali has written. There are amazing booklets, lots of them, being assertive, constructive criticism, and many, many such booklets. In fact, many of these topics are even covered in the counseling course that we have. So all of you are welcome. Please come down to our academy. We are always there for you and we'd be glad to help you. Thank you all so much. Thanks a lot.